and thank you for joining us today for this episode of E3 Explorers, where we're blazing the trail to a beautiful life. My name is Jamie Christian, and I'm the founder and executive director of Let Us Turn Up the Beet Sustainability Collective. A few years ago, I started creating and teaching sustainability education programs to kids and their families in the Pittsburgh area. Sustainability education is important because it teaches us how to protect our environment, become better stewards of our local food system, live a healthier lifestyle, and produce more while consuming and wasting less. Throughout our journey, we'll be learning all about the three pillars of sustainability: ecology, equity, and economics, with segments focusing on the environment, agriculture, self-care, nutrition, and responsible economic practices. We're so excited to have you with us today because it's Watershed Awareness Month, and March 22nd is World Water Day. And our show today is all about H2O.
Self-care.
Hey friends, today we are beginning our exploration of the amazing molecule H2O, discovering why water is essential to our overall well-being, as well as the importance of hydration and controlling inflammation within our bodies. To find our answers, we first have to ask some very important questions. First, what is water? Water is the molecule H2O, and it is made of two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. Why do we need water? Water serves a number of essential functions to keep us all going and is important to all living things. The human brain and heart are composed of 73% water. Our lungs are about 83% water. Skin contains 64% water. Muscles and kidneys are 79% water. And our bones are 31% water as well. Some organisms are up to 90% water. A human adult male is 60% water, and women are 55% water. Babies are 78% water at birth and decrease to around 65% by the time they are 1 year of age. So why is there a difference in the amount of water in our bodies? Simple, fat tissue doesn't have as much water as lean tissue. Adult women have more fat than men and have less water than men, where babies and kids have less fat and therefore more water than adults. The percentage of water can vary per person as well. People with more fatty tissue have less water than people with less fatty tissue. Now that we've answered some questions about water and hydration, let's take a look at essential body functions and how water plays a role. Water is a vital nutrient to the life of every cell, which acts first as a building material. Adding water to our bodies is called hydration, and we mainly do that by drinking. Water helps us to control our weight, regulates our internal body temperature by sweat and respiration, forms saliva, which keeps our mouths healthy, and provides a shock absorber for our brains and spinal cords. Water lubricates joints, which can reduce pain, and it can decrease inflammation by diluting toxins and flushing away waste. Pain is just not fun, and inflammation can not only be painful, but detrimental to our mental and emotional health as well. Inflammation is our body's natural response to protect itself from danger. There are two types, acute, which goes away, and chronic, which doesn't go away. Acute inflammation is our body's response to infection or injury. Our bodies protect us by increasing the amount of blood in the affected area so that white blood cells can kill bacteria and viruses. Acute inflammation may also occur to prevent further damage to an already injured body part. Chronic inflammation can be the result of the untreated causes of acute inflammation, an autoimmune disorder, which involves your immune system mistakenly attacking healthy tissue, long-term exposure to irritants, such as industrial chemicals or polluted air, and an excess of fat cells, especially fat in the belly area. Inflammation can also impact our mental and emotional well-being and performance. Inflammation in the brain can cause symptoms of depression and anxiety, and have an adverse effect on our social emotional learning and cognition. Small secreted proteins called cytokines send messages between cells. Increased inflammation and anxiety-related disorders are the effects of inflammatory cytokines on brain regions involving fear, anxiety, and threat detection. Inflammation can also cause alteration in the brain's reward circuitry system. Elevated inflammatory cytokines reduce neural activity and dopamine release in reward-related brain regions in association with reduced motivation, making us sad, overwhelmed, and not really wanting to do much of anything. The cortical basal ganglial network is a fundamental component of this circuit, which impacts our behaviors and good decision-making. The prefrontal cortex uses the basal ganglia for additional processing of rewards to effectively modulate learning. Increased inflammation can hinder the development of goal-directed behaviors and action plans. When we're properly hydrated, we can reduce the amount of inflammation in our bodies and our brains, which leads to less pain, fewer symptoms of depression and anxiety, improved executive functions, and better decision-making and behaviors. But what about the most important question? I bet you've been wondering this all along. How much water do humans need to consume each day? It varies according to age and gender, and also by where someone lives. Altitude and humidity also determine how much water our body needs to function at its peak. An adult male needs around 3 liters, or 3.2 quarts of water per day. An adult female, about 2.2 liters, or 2.3 quarts per day. And children need between 5 and 8 8-ounce cups per day. I know what you're all thinking. That's a lot of water. How can I drink that much water in a day? No worries. All of the water that a person needs does not have to come from drinking liquids, as some of this water is contained in the food that we eat. You can find out exactly how much water you need to stay healthy and happy by visiting
the Allegheny County Library Association is a federated system of 46 independent libraries, all of whom have their own governance structure. And we're always looking for people to help support libraries, serving on a committee, serving on a board. If you're interested, we are establishing something called the Allegheny County Library Association Talent Bank, and we're looking for you. On behalf of the Allegheny County Library Association, I want to thank you for your interest in libraries. If you visited a library recently, well, you've probably discovered they aren't just warehouses of books. In fact, libraries are community support centers, places where people connect with each other and with the information and resources they need every day. Maybe you want to find a job or learn to be a better parent. Maybe you want to fix your car or even bake a souffle. The library is a place where you can find what you need. In addition to books, libraries offer music, videos, computers, free Wi-Fi, classes, workshops, story times, oh, and even probably the pan to bake your souffle. Because libraries represent all of our community needs, it's absolutely essential that library leadership reflect the people who live in our communities. That's why ACLA has developed the Talent Bank.
With the Talent Bank, our goal is to increase opportunities for community members to serve in significant roles at their local libraries. The boards and committees of the 46 member libraries must reflect the rich diversity of our communities and the library users as well as the supporters. There are many ways in which libraries will benefit by making inclusivity and diversity a priority. Organizations with diverse leadership are more likely to understand the needs of a diverse client base. Research shows that a diversity of perspectives in decision making leads to better outcomes. Donors and clients want to see themselves reflected in the organizations that serve them and that they support. The Talent Bank is one of many actions we are taking to provide community members with opportunities to get involved with their local libraries.
As a community leader and as a business owner in my community, one of the things that I really stress and I try and do is surround myself with other business people that have the same skills and or thoughts for the community itself. And being a member of the community, but being involved in the community is extremely important to me. and I volunteer on quite a few different boards in our community, but my favorite is our public library. Being on the library board itself has been instrumental in helping me in the business and helping me network throughout the community itself.
Just about every library user has a unique story about their relationship with their local library. Something special about that experience. Be part of the library of the future by registering for the ACLA Talent Bank.
So if you've been listening to us, I'm sure you're intrigued. And we welcome all of you to sign up. Just join the Talent Bank. You can access that through the ACLA website at aclalibraries.org, or you can call your local library. And you don't have to necessarily just sign up for a board. You can also sign up to be on a committee. That's one way to get to know the library and for the library to get to know you. So please show your love of libraries, get involved, join the Talent Bank now.
Nutrition. Today's recipe is golden milk. Your ingredients are a half a cup or 120 milliliters of an unsweetened milk of your choice. Today, I'm going to use dairy milk, but oat milk and cashew milk can also be used. Cashews are a natural anti-inflammatory, so that can help even more. 1 teaspoon of turmeric, 1 small piece of grated fresh ginger, or a half a teaspoon of ginger powder, 1/2 teaspoon of cinnamon powder, 1 pinch of ground black pepper, and optional, 1 teaspoon of honey or maple syrup. To make the golden milk, simply mix all ingredients in a small saucepan or pot. Bring to a boil. Reduce the heat and simmer for about 10 minutes or until fragrant and flavorful. Strain the drink through a fine strainer into mugs and top with a pinch of cinnamon. Golden milk can also be made in advance and stored in your refrigerator for up to 5 days. Simply reheat it before drinking. Enjoy!
Ecology. Did you know that Pennsylvania has the second most streams in the country? Only Alaska has more streams than Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania has over 86,000 miles of stream. I'm sure you know the big streams around here, like the Ohio River, the Allegheny River, and the Monongahela River. The Allegheny and the Monongahela River flow together at Point State Park and then form the Ohio River. So what about all the other miles of streams? There are many tributaries that contribute to the larger stream systems. A tributary is a stream or river that flows into a larger stream or river. The headwater of a stream is where the stream starts, where it first becomes a stream. Sometimes the water will come from a spring or seep in the ground. This is usually called an intermittent stream. Usually the water flows, but sometimes it doesn't. But it doesn't matter, it's still a stream. This is a tributary to Mingo Creek. As you can see, there is no water in it right now. This is called an ephemeral tributary, which means it only has water in it some of the time, when there's direct precipitation. If you could imagine that it's raining, or there's snow melting on the hill, it would come down, flow into this tributary, and then flow into Mingo Creek. Regardless of the type of stream, all streams will have substrate, like rocks, sand, silt, or clay, and they will also have a defined bank. All tributaries are part of something called a watershed. So what is a watershed, you ask? Many small watersheds make up larger watersheds, or river basins. In Pennsylvania, there are over 100 watersheds that fall into 6 main river basins. River basin will eventually flow into a major river, which will then flow into a very large lake, or the ocean. In southwestern Pennsylvania, we are in the Ohio River Basin. The Ohio River is almost 1,000 miles long. Then it flows into the Mississippi River, which then flows into the Atlantic Ocean. So as you see on this map, we were in the pink zone. See how much of the country is also in the pink zone? That means all of the streams in all of those states eventually flow into the Atlantic Ocean. We are all connected. Since bugs are so small and can't move far and fast like fish, they can generally give you a good picture of what the water quality is like in your stream. Some species like mayflies, stoneflies, and caddisflies can't live in very polluted waters, so if you have a lot of them, that means you have good water quality. However, some like blackflies and mosquitoes can live in polluted waters, so if you have a lot of those kind of bugs and not a lot of the good kind of bugs, you might have water that does not have a lot of oxygen because of some kinds of pollution or because of a lot of silt in it. Silt will take up all the oxygen and it'll actually make the stream look like chocolate milk. So where exactly do you find these bugs at? Well, they are broken down into five different groups based on where they like to hang out in the stream. You have your grazers and scrapers. They eat algae and other film off rocks, so they like to hang out on rocks like the mayflies and some kinds of caddisflies. Caddisflies are super cool because they will make their houses out of small rocks and sand. They cement their houses together with silk, like spiders used, and their saliva. Shredder bugs will crawl on the bottom of the stream looking for vegetation to shred up and eat. Some caddisflies will make their cases out of shredded leaves and plants. Other shredders are the cranefly larvae. Collector-gatherers like stoneflies and mayflies, and even some other kinds of caddisflies, will wander the bottom of the stream and eat pieces of dead things or other food that gets stuck between rocks. Filter feeder bugs will either swim through the water or sit on the bottom and filter out small pieces of materials that other insects leave behind. Mussels and clams are very good at cleaning up streams because they filter out pollution. Predators will feed on other insects. Some of these include the water beetle, which actually lives its whole life in water, or dragonfly larvae. Some dragonfly larvae will actually eat fish. So this is why headwater streams are so important, because headwater streams flow into larger streams, which flow even more. To even larger streams. So any type of pollution that gets into even a small stream can eventually keep flowing into bigger streams, which could kill fish, frogs, and even get into your drinking water. So how do you tell if a stream is healthy? Do you see fish swimming around? What if it's a smaller stream and fish might not live in there? Do you need fancy equipment to do this? No, you don't, because bugs don't lie. So let's flip some rocks and look for bugs. These are called water pennies. They are the larval form of a riffle beetle. They are scrapers, and they will hang out in rocks and scrape off thin layers of algae. They do not do well in streams with polluted water or lots of thick algae or sediment. Here I am in another stream in Washington County. It is in an area where the sewer line needs to be replaced, so the streams are a little polluted. Those black blob things swimming around, they're called flatworms. The little shrimp-looking things are called scuds. They are very tolerant of pollution. There are so many of them, it is a very good indication that the stream does not have good water quality.
Hi guys, I hope you had fun. Thanks for joining us today to learn about bugs in the streams of southwestern Pennsylvania.
One of the things we do at BPTV is encourage our producers to film on location. Not only does shooting on location give our producers the opportunity to take advantage of their subject matter, filming in different locations gives each program its own distinct flavor. This also helps anyone who's flipping through the channels avoid confusion when they turn on BPTV. With around 500 programs produced at BPTV each year, the last thing we want people to think is that we're only broadcasting one program. So, you need to come into BPTV to pitch your TV show. But in terms of where you actually end up taping your show, the sky's the limit.
Avocado. nature.
Midwinter is not the time of year you would expect to be good for your garden. It's dark, it's cold, and it's snowy. The snow especially might make you think that your garden is under siege. When most people think of a snowy garden, they think of the downfalls. Heavy snow breaking the tree and shrub branches, or a late snow in the spring harming those early growing plants. But snow's benefits for your garden actually far outweigh the negatives. Winter is a very harsh time of year for plants. The freezing temperatures make it difficult for plants to take up water. But snow can make a difference. Snow insulates the ground, which reduces water loss from the soil. Brooklyn Botanical Garden curator Michael Morrow said in an interview that, quote, "Snow can act like a blanket, protecting new growth from extreme temperatures and wind while keeping the plants moist. The snow insulates the plant's cells, preventing water inside of the cells from freezing as readily, which could damage the plant. It also protects plants from harsh, drying winds. Without snow, the winds could pull moisture from the plant's leaves, causing winter burn. This is especially true for new growth in the early spring. In the spring, the melting snow also helps to give water to the plants, providing a much-needed drink after a long, dry winter. Snow is the perfect insulating blanket to help your plants, and it does so often by insulating the ground. The air under the snow is actually warmer than the air above the snow, thanks to its insulating properties. This keeps the ground from freezing as deeply, which protects the roots of trees and shrubs. Some trees even use this time to grow new roots thanks to the cover that the snow provides. It also reduces the impact of daily temperature changes, which could otherwise cause repeated thawing and freezing. Excessive thawing and refreezing can actually uproot plants from the ground, so the snow's protection helps to keep them in. Have you ever heard of snow being referred to as the poor man's fertilizer? Since snow slows how quickly the ground freezes, this allows for decomposers, such as worms and beetles, to have more time to break down organic matter, making nutrient-rich soil or compost. Snow can also add nitrogen and sulfur to the ground. Snowflakes catch these nutrients as they fall through the air. Nutrients like nitrogen are vital for plant growth, so adding them to the soil before spring is a great help. Finally, there are many plants that actually prefer or even need the snow. Plants like roses, apples, and pears actually grow or produce more readily after a snowy winter. Snow provides a period of cool, even temperatures for plants that require it, such as daffodil bulbs. Last spring, only about half of my daffodils grew because last winter was too warm. We barely got any snow. There are also many perennial seeds, such as lupin and milkweed, that need to be cold stratified or spend time in cold temperatures in order to germinate and grow. Hopefully, our nice snowy winter this year will give our gardens the boost they need.
Did you know that almost 71% of the earth is made up of water? Only 2.5% of the earth's water is fresh water. The other 97.5% of the earth's water is salt water. Water is vital to all life. The limited supply of fresh water is becoming one of our most precious resources and in need of our protection. Many areas of the world suffer from clean water shortages due to pollution and droughts. We need water for drinking, bathing, cooking, washing, and other activities like gardening. Fruits and vegetables require water to grow, and every species of plant and animals on Earth need water to survive. Every living thing is made up mostly of water, and some beings even live in water. And some of us wish we could live in water, too. Safe and readily available water is important for public health, whether it is used for drinking, domestic use, food production, or recreational purposes. Improved water supply and sanitation and better management of water resources can boost countries' economic growth and can contribute greatly to poverty reduction. In 2010, the United Nations General Assembly explicitly recognized the human right to water and sanitation. Everyone has the right to sufficient, continuous, safe, acceptable, physically accessible, and affordable water for personal and domestic use.
I bet you're thinking, well, I'm just a kid. How can I protect our fresh water supply? Well, it's easy.
Through water conservation. Conserving water means using our water supply wisely and responsibly and keeping our water clean. We can do this simply by cutting down on the amount of water that we use at home, being mindful of what types of weed and pest control we are using for our lawn and gardens, and also being mindful of where we deposit our waste. By conserving water, we not only protect our fresh water supply, but we also save money and energy. When we use water at home, most of the time it isn't free, unless there is a well or fresh water spring nearby. Most of us purchase our water from a local water company. They treat and filter it so that it is safe for consumption, then pump it through an aqueduct system where it travels many, many miles to your tap. When we use less, we spend less, and we waste less. So now that we know what conserving water means and its benefits, here's how you and your family can start at home. Turn off the faucet while brushing your teeth. Only run the washing machine and dishwasher when you have a full load. Use a low-flow showerhead and faucet aerators. Fix leaks. Install a dual flush or low-flow toilet, or put a conversion kit on your existing toilet. Don't overwater your lawn or water during peak periods, and install rain sensors on irrigation systems. Install a rain barrel for outdoor watering. Plant a rain garden for catching stormwater runoff from your roof, driveway, and other hard surfaces. Monitor your water usage on your water bill and ask your local government about a home water audit. And last but not least, share your knowledge about saving water through conservation and efficiency with your neighbors. Communication and education are the easiest and most effective ways to protect our fresh water supply and help others blaze the trail to a beautiful life. Thank you for joining us today for this episode of E3 Explorers. We will see you soon. Be well, my friends.
Kim Adley, host of Passport to Pittsburgh Adventures and Big Ideas for Little People. It's been such a great thrill working with BPTV. BPTV has become like a group of friends who work together to be creative and put out messages for the community, the viewers, you. And it's just been a wonderful, rewarding experience.
Hi, I'm Susan Roberti, and today I am allowed to talk about BPTV. I love it, I love it, I love it. I have been here for over 20 years making shows, and it's not to be afraid. You come up and you talk about things that you love and things that you want to share, and it's just opens your mind to so many different things. It's different. It's not the everyday thing. Please come up and visit. So I love you, like always. Come on up and do a show. Don't be afraid. Once you do one, I tell you, you'll get addicted. And most of all, God bless Bethel Park and God bless America.